because I remember walking in his living room. I remember it. He lived on Vine Street, walked on up the back steps, going on the back up the back steps. So he said, you have to understand, we started out knowing each other, playing for the State Trooper Eagles, midget football, when we were 10. And that's when I first met Willie.
I have to say that I didn't really value his music taste when I was in high school because he was a big fan of the Carpenters.
Belong to me, close to you.
But anyway, he forced me in his Dodge Dart and his 8-track to listen to this performer he heard from New Jersey.
And I'm hearing all the Springsteen stuff going on, which was new to me. And all a lot of the guys and the girls in school there were from the Jersey Shore. So I immediately became enamored with all Springsteen. It was Greetings from Asbury Park album was the first one. And then The Wild, the Innocent East Street Shuffle was the one I gave him.
And he put this 8-track in, and it was The Wild, the Innocent, and the East Street Shuffle. And it was the first time I heard Bruce.
And I said, listen, you need to play this. Learn this guy and play this stuff. He's going to be like the biggest thing ever.
And I had opinions that maybe this was somebody copying Blood, Sweat, and Tears music a little bit with a lot of improvisation, it seemed like, and some dissonant horn sounds. But then again, there was like a Bob Dylan type of lyrical singer, you know what I mean, with a lot of lyrics.
And Willie said to me, but you can't dance to it. And I said, you know, I want to strangle him. Don't worry about that. I want to hear you play this music because it is great and it's going to be profound for many years to come.
We ought to be street band from New Jersey. Our band is the longest running tribute band in the world. We're a tribute to Bruce Springsteen. We are in our 36th year.
Sparks fly on East Street where the boy probably walks in handsome and high. They're doing the East Street show.
Welcome to the Jersey Shore. It's played a major role in so many different lives. But one thing's for sure, there wasn't a better place for live music back in the late 70s and early 80s. It felt like you were inside a Bruce Springsteen song, Joe Maloney said, when he was photographing Asbury Park during that time. And for rock bands, work was abundant.
We came to Jersey and learned the history of Bruce Springsteen and the E Street Band. We lived in Asbury Park. We saw, we experienced, right? This is where we gotta go. If we wanna be a band and we wanna do something, this is where we have. The Jersey Shore was perfect, right? But we had a few Springsteen songs in our repertoire at that time. And as we played those songs over, we played 6-7 days a week. As we played those songs during periods of the night, I noticed there was this response of, we grabbed people's attention. All this, they heard that, and they flocked to the stage. We got to play a night with Clarence Clemons. It was a benefit up in Atlantic Highlands. And we were excited because we're gonna see Clarence, gonna play with Clarence, you know? 2,000 people came. The crowd response was incredible. I don't know if it was so much fun for Clarence because, you know, he plays with Bruce. Now he's playing with us, you know? I saw the response. That was the night that the light bulb went off. And I thought to myself, maybe we can do this full time doing just Bruce's music. That was the start of it. Subsequently, a night after that, Max Weinberg came in and played with us, an hour, 15 minutes with us. And we went into the Bruce repertoire with him, which he loved because he hadn't been playing at all. So he got a kick out of it, you know? And we did it well. That added on. So I made a decision at some point in the late 79 that I think this is the way we're gonna go about, we're gonna change it. We're gonna become a Springsteen tribute band. And I would say 95% of people's opinions were, that's crazy. I went to the Stone Pony in Asbury Park and they didn't want any part of it. And I knew the owner there, he knew me. And said, I don't like the idea. I just don't think it's gonna work. So we went to a club down the street that our agent actually had purchased at that time, an agent. And we did a night, May 19th, 1980, and 2,000 people came, and it was a great success. But what it did is it sent waves throughout the club music industry that there was a hot act, something different, something that was totally different from what anybody else was doing. When we began the Springsteen Tribute in 1980, we were living in Asbury Park. Tons of Asbury Park musicians that grew up with Bruce and a Holy Street band, knew them, first name, basses, and everything else. Jersey likes that you do Bruce's music. They don't want you to be Bruce. Bruce is alive. There's a fine point that we had to find in between that so that we were accepted by the musicians and the cult Bruce fans, all right, at that time period in the early 80s, that they realized we were filling a void. We were filling the void when the performer wasn't around or when they couldn't go see the performer or couldn't afford to go see the performer. We were filling that void, but we were not crossing the line to thinking that we were Bruce, all right? That's a dead end road. You know?
They did it at the right time. It was just good timing. When they started in the late 70s, but there was, on any given night, there's 1,000 people out in the club. There was more clubs, and it was just the perfect timing, And it's kind of crazy. It has not just last this long, but be as successful as it is. Some people can't even, other musicians are like, it's incredible, I saw a guy here last week. He's like, I can't believe these guys still have all this work,
You figure it out. They came out when The River came out. Here they are, 30 some odd years together. It's the greatest thing in the world.
And the shore, everything's all right. You and your baby on a Saturday night. Darling, all of my dreams come true.
Can this story of the B Street Band happen anywhere else aside from New Jersey?
I don't think so. I know there are other tribute bands that do the whole Springsteen thing all over the country, but I don't think you have the fan base in other parts of the country that you have here.
Well, they were in the right place at the right time. They were in New Jersey, and they started at the right time. As Bruce got bigger, the B Street Band got bigger.
And they've been together, 35 years now, 36 years. I mean, phenomenal. I mean, who does that? How many bands have you seen do something like that?
Is it a story that can only happen in New Jersey, connected to Bruce Springsteen
Yes.
doing something for 35
Yes, the
years?
The Jersey Shore, listen, I grew up on the Jersey Shore. I worked Seaside Heights when I was a kid. I used to run the Himalaya and the Swiss Bop. That was my voice. I was a big hit in the late 70s. Everything is related to the Jersey Shore. There's nothing like it. I don't care if you're 5 years old or you're 70 years old. There's something about the Jersey Shore, Bruce music, B Street Band. It's a connection. It's the Jersey Shore, and there's nothing like it. These guys just have it. There's just something about it, and it's the Jersey Shore.
What is it?
It's from the Jersey Shore. I'm sorry. It's a part of it, and they all are from the Jersey Shore.
Obviously, the most rabid, greatest Springsteen fans are here in New Jersey. I'm one of them, but I mean, only in New Jersey. And Willie, the fact that he had the fortitude to do this in 1980, when Bruce was still alive, is amazing. So, no, it couldn't happen anywhere else but in New Jersey.
I one time heard the writer Dave Marsh, who is a right hand to Bruce, and I heard him being critical of bands like B Street Band and critical of the other tribute bands. And I just shake my head to hear that, because it's so elite. Because I know that if I want to come to New Jersey in the summertime, if I want to go to the shore, whether it be the north part of the Jersey Shore, the south part, LBI, I know that I can hear Bruce music. I can find B Street Band, and I know that I can hear more Bruce than Bruce plays when he's not home, when he's not touring. And that is a happy time.
I mean, I know people in other parts of the country who are Springsteen fans, and they always say, I wish I lived in Jersey. I wish I had this. I wish, I wish I could get my fix. I wish, but they don't even understand what this really is because they haven't even experienced this. But, I talk about, Glenn and Willie and B Street all the time. I mean, they're important to me. They would probably be very, think I'm very strange if I said these things to them. But, I think they know it.
So I remember going to see these guys at Martell's when Glenn first joined, which is in Point Pleasant. And there was 500 people there. And I said to myself, wow, and it was a Monday night, Paul. And I said to myself, wow, Monday night, the Jersey Shore. And then I went to go see him Wednesday night in Sayreville, and there was 500 people. This was 1991. That's what makes it, it's insane. They are as Jersey as, I hate to say it, boss, but they're as Jersey as you. I'm sorry. And Bon Jovi.
This is why I'm here.
My biggest fear is I don't want to come off like the crazy guy who thinks he's Bruce Springsteen. You know, I really, really try to keep it in perspective. It's a gig. I'm a big fan. I love doing the gig. I mean, I'm glad it's Bruce Springsteen's music that caught on. I would hate to be like in the Culture Club tribute band, you know?
Ooh. Daddy's not too good.
Meet Glenn Stewart. By day, he's a soccer dad.
You know, what the hell is soccer? Nobody knew what soccer was.
He's a Jersey guy. A real Jersey guy.
Do your homework? What? Did you take out the garbage? What? You ready?
Typical suburban New Jersey family.
Favorite daughter in the whole world. All right, we're going inside. Because Daddy's had enough.
And by night, he's been fronting the B Street Band since 1990.
Okay, Lucy, I'm off to the club.
Okay. Bye.
Love you.
Glenn's path to Bruce Springsteen was quite different than Willie Forte's.
I was in Asbury Park with my parents, and I was going through a record. There was some kind of a record thing by the Paramount Theater there. I don't even know what it was. But there was a bunch of Springsteen bootlegs. And I had no idea who he was. I had no idea what he sounded like. But, you know, obviously he was from New Jersey, so I kind of got interested. And then right after that, Born to Run came out. So the first record I ever bought was Born to Run, and then I went out and bought the other ones after that.
He brought a different type of persona that had Bruce's charisma.
Two chips angel room, filled us nice. Together we dance like spirits in the night. All night, all night. All night.
Some of his talent looked a little bit like him. Doesn't act like him, though. Had his politics, maybe left the Bruce, you know. We evolved into a band that wanted to have fun.
Dance and be proud of it, no matter how badly I sucked.
I was in the crowd the first night they ever played. I was working with a friend of mine who I worked with for 15 years before I even joined this band.
But we were standing there in the crowd. It was packed, mobbed. There was a line going around the block. There was searchlights out in front. It looked like a Hollywood premiere. It was amazing. And he's elbowing me the whole time. He said, you know, we should do this. We could do this. You could do this better than this guy. You're great. And I'm telling him, this ain't going to last. Bruce Springsteen's still alive. You can go see him play. Why would anybody want to pay money to go see somebody sound like Bruce Springsteen? So anyway, here we are 25 years later.
He had to play more of the part in the beginning and take on a personality that was a little bit, you know, kind of Springsteen-ish. But that's completely gone. Glenn is up and Glenn is Glenn. And it just so happens that he's got, you know, as quick a wit, as great a voice, as amazing a stage presence as Springsteen, and yet, you know, didn't have the breaks in his career and didn't have the songwriting capability to, you know, turn it into more than it is.
I don't feel like I have to represent Bruce Springsteen in any way. I mean, he does that pretty well on his own. It's tough, let me tell you, because he's in such damn good shape and he looks so damn good and he's still so damn viable that it's hard to keep up with him because he looks better than I do and he's 10 years older than me. In that regard, yeah, that's a burden. I wish he would just get fat and bald and old like everybody else, but he has his own plan.
On the Bay Streets, riding on the Bay Streets, I look so hard to fit with it.
Glenn is a younger version of Bruce, and the man amazes me that I think he, whatever song you pick out, he knows the words.
I'm amazed by your memory of lyrics. I mean, these are tough songs to sing.
I mean, first of all, it's my job, so I gotta do it.
Yeah.
I like Bruce Springsteen. I like what Bruce Springsteen represents. I like his music. I like his writing. I generally like his philosophy, so the songs come easy to me. Actually, I've always been really good at remembering lyrics. I'm really bad at remembering chords. I forget chords to songs we've been playing for 20 years. So. I like the music. I generally like the music. I always felt that if I couldn't be a rock star myself, I mean, at least I enjoy playing this music, and I enjoy what it represents, and I enjoy the persona that he represents. I don't really feel like I have to be something that I'm not. So it's comes easy.
Screen or slam, there is restway. Light of the she dances across the porch as the radio plays. Roy Orbison sang for all.
The song that I like to play the most is still Thunder Road. Yeah, that's always been my favorite. My actual favorite Bruce Springsteen song is a song called Wild Billy Circus Story, which, you know, is just a kind of B-C song from Greetings from Asbury Park. But for some reason, that song has always resonated because I remember growing up in the same area that he grew up in, and like the Clyde Beatty Circus would come to Freehold Raceway and set up in the parking lot. When I was a kid, I worked at Great Adventure for a while, and one of my jobs was I worked in a circus show. When I was a real little kid, one of my favorite movies was a Disney movie called Toby Tyler, about a little boy who runs away and joins the circus. So that whole circus theme in that song has always resonated with me. But as far as what we do, as far as playing goes, I think Thunder Road is probably... I never really get tired of playing this song.
Take home, Thunder Road. Well, I got this guitar and I learned how to make her talk. My car's at back, you're ready to take that long walk from your front porch to my front seat.
How would you compare and contrast you and Bruce?
Well, he's a iconic rock superstar legend, and I'm a schlub in a band playing at the Golden Nugget in Atlantic City, for starters. I don't know. I don't know how to honestly answer that question. There is no comparison, and there is, you know, I mean, he's Bruce Springsteen.
Do you feel you do an imitation of Bruce?
I don't try to. I mean, I don't necessarily try to. People ask me that all the time. Do you study films? I mean, I don't study them and watch them. I try to grab a vibe. You know, I've been a big fan since I was a kid.
Maybe you went to chase cats all night long. Did hear them
trying to entertain myself. I heard him say that in an interview once that he basically tries to entertain himself, and he figures if he could entertain himself, then everybody else was being entertained too. So I kind of gravitated to that philosophy.
It's like when I play with Bruce. Now Glenn's doing Bruce. You gotta watch Glenn. I do. That's why you gotta watch Bruce. You don't know when certain things are gonna happen, because Bruce is gonna dictate through the music how that happens. And Glenn doesn't quite do that, but you gotta watch him. You gotta know where he is at all times.
You know, Bruce is, you know, he's more unreachable. He's out there, he's creating the music, he's creating the lyrics, which are, you can't beat them. But at the same time, you know, Glenn is more, you can reach him. He's there, he's right in front of you, and you can connect with him, and he can look at you, and, you know, it's a different experience. It's nice to have that personal connection. And they get to know their audience. I mean, they know me. You know, Bruce doesn't know me. I wish he did. Everybody says, he should know you by now. No, he doesn't know me. He doesn't care about me. He cares in the sense that he cares about his fans, but he doesn't know me. And Glenn does care.
Girls on stage. I'm amazed by that too, that you guys allow it to happen, and just kind of describe the experience, what that's like.
Sometimes it's fun, sometimes it's frightening. We don't even allow them, really. They just kind of end up there, and what are you going to do? I'm not security. I'm not a bouncer. I can't be throwing people off the stage left and right. Is it flattering? Yeah. At sometimes, is it frightening? Yeah. Does my wife like it? No. But it's got little to do with us. I mean, it's more to do with just being caught up in the moment and the alcohol and just jumping up on stage. And you know, once the show is over and the lights come up, everybody's out of here like rats off a ship, you know. And you stand in the middle of the dance floor going, hey, hey, anybody? I'm here. It's a cool guy. So it's, you know, it's real world slaps you in the face really quick.
If I was across the room and I didn't know the band, and I saw Glenn, I would swear he was Springsteen.
Nobody could sing Bruce Springsteen songs like Glenn Stewart.
1, 2, 3, I was down with broken heroes, homeless, tense power truck. Everybody's out on the run of me.
You know as well as I do, if you go to Jersey, there's a lot of working guys that look like that. You know, it's like if you go to downtown New York City, there's a lot of girls that look like J-Lo.
Well, I mean, of course, there's one, Mr. Springsteen, that's it. I'm still waiting to meet, by the way. And so that's that. But Glenn really, I mean, you know, from a little bit of a distance, there's similarities just facially and body structure and everything. So he sings and performs at a very similar energy level. And but, I mean, I'm not trying to say, you know, he's another Babe Ruth, but he's definitely very good at what he does. And I think when people show up to see the B Street Band and watch him perform, they're never cheated, man. And that's the other thing I'm always impressed by.
I mean, like most people, when I was younger, I wanted to be a rock star. When that didn't happen, I'm lucky that I fell into this and I've been able to do this and, you know, live the life of a rock star vicariously through another rock star. But it's something that I always wanted to do, and I enjoy doing it. There is a certain amount of acting involved. I mean, you get up there, and it does transform you, because it's like being in a Broadway show. Once you get on the stage and it's happening, it becomes, you know, you become what it is.
The hungry and the hungry explode in a rock and roll, man. They face off against each other out in the street. Come on, man.
But then when it's done, I mean, I can also get in the car, drive home, and, you know, stop at 7-Eleven on the way home, pick up milk, you know, and love my wife and my kids and my family and my life.
If I didn't do what I do, I'd have to be doing this. You know what it's like to be wearing a suit and a tie on the Jersey Shore in the middle of August? This is why I do what I do.
So what would it be like to have Bruce and Glenn on the stage at the same time?
I don't know if I could handle the strain.
You know, we were like the satellites around Bruce, small satellites that travel around him that don't get noticed, you know, too much from his end. But, you know, we saw being connected to him, we noticed the changes in his life from when he started early and how his music changed. And his experiences and the things that happened to him changed us also a little bit, whether it was maybe getting married, maybe getting divorced, you know, leaving the E Street Band and forming another band, okay? Letting that go and rejoining the E Street Band. All of those situations over the years affected what we do, you know, because we had to adjust professionally to that, but there was also an emotional attachment that when members of the E Street Band passed away, that was like our family passing away. It was, we were part of that for so many years. There was such a connection, you know? So I think between the music that he created, how much it's affected me personally, and the experiences that we had because of his life, of those 35 years specifically, it changed us, sculpted what we do, and it changed me personally and members of the band.
Suppose you got a men's softball team. You're pretty good. You're okay. You're not bad for what you do, where you play, the league you're in. One day, just before game time, you're about to go on and play. Suddenly, Derek Jeter shows up. Jeter shows up and says, you know what? I got nothing to do for the next 20, 30 minutes. Let me play an inning or two.
I think what the B Street Band is doing is great. And, you know, it's great that they've taken the body of work and made it work for themselves. That's what music is all about, having fun with it. And, you know, judging by the reaction to the crowd here tonight, it's working for them. So I wish them a lot of luck in the future doing exactly what they're doing.
Scary if they've been doing it 30 years, you know. I don't know who they're imitating. It's not me. Maybe my father, but it's not me.
Like Bruce knows about him. Believe me, he does, you know. But like Bruce, I think he told a friend of mine once, because a friend of mine, while I'm standing there, called up, says, hey, B Street's at the deck, you know. Come on down. We know you're here. He goes, if I come, it's like Santa Claus really coming on Christmas, he says, Bruce.
If he came we created this frenzy that Bruce comes to see us, and the only reason people would be coming to see our band is because they think Bruce is going to stop and see us. You know, I really don't want any part of that history of that happening. But if If I knew I only had 3 months left in this band, I would want him there every night.
It's incredible to see your fans that have been following you for 20, 25, 30 years. What do you make of these people who have followed you guys?
It's crazy. They're dedicated fans. I mean, that's Springsteen fans. Movies have been made about Springsteen fans, Springsteen and I. They are tenacious, loving fans. And over the years, like anything else, if you get to see people enough, you get to know them. And we have become a lot of parts of these people's lives. It's incredible, but it's true. It's very intimate, and they've gotten to know us. They know us as people now over the years. And it's to some kind of dysfunctional degree, it's a big family.
And they tell us their stories, whether it's that they got through hard times by coming to see the band.
Well, I have cancer and stage 4. They just make me feel good. By seeing them, it just takes me away from my problem. I just love their music. That's basically, and they're nice guys also. Because they've put a lot of joy in my life. And I thank them on numerous occasions. Yeah.
My husband passed away 4 years ago, and it was just, you know, it was a very short, a quick illness. It was terrible, you know, 8.5 months. But so during that time, I think we only got to see the band one time. And after he had passed, about 2 days later, it was actually 2 or 3 days after I buried him, and we went to go see the band in Jersey City. You know, they couldn't have been more supportive and more kind, and it was really important for me to be there and kind of just, you know, I had about 25 friends and family with me, and I just felt their support, and it meant a lot. So that's definitely, that was definitely a big one.
You know, Bruce Springsteen himself does something totally different than any of those bands do. He really connects a person with it. He connects people with geography, he connects people with automobiles, he connects people with love, he connects people with hope, with despair, with the American way, with hard work and all that. And that's what I see when I see these guys. I see journeymen working guys. I don't see guys that are pretending that they're somebody.
And as we got to know them, they became friends. And literally when I was 35, Steve Barr, who's the lead guitarist, and Willie, said to me, look, if you take up the guitar and you get good enough, someday we'll let you come play on the stage. And so my wife bought me a left-handed guitar that year. This is when I was 35 is when I started. And it took me 6 years to get to the point where they would actually let me come on the stage. And I can remember the first time I played, it was actually in Wildwood. I think it was called like the Beach Club or something, and they let me come on stage. And you know, they let me play a couple like three chord songs, you know, like Trapped, you know, three chords. And once I had the bug, there was just no stopping me. At that, you know, once I had the bug and I played once, I just wanted to play with them all the time. So I really worked at it for a long time with them. And, you know, these guys became very good friends. And, you know, it got to the point over the years where I could just show up and play with them whenever I wanted. So I've played with them hundreds of times now. Since the late 90s.
1994, when I got married, they played my wedding. They were one of the first weddings. My wife and my wedding was one of the first ones they've done.
John talked us into having. He said, we're going to do our wedding song, but I'll tell you what it is once we get to the wedding. Because if I tell you now, you're probably not going to want to play it. I said, John, what song would I not want to play, you know?
My wife and I love the song Trapped, which is like the anti-love song.
And I said, John, John, how could you have trapped at your wedding? He said, let's just say it. I'm doing it for all the grooms out there that under their last song before they get married, I'm representing that.
People say, we can't believe this is the song. Trapped, you know, I'm caught up in your trap again. And we're out there dancing, and my wife will go, I'm
Well, actually, I think it's more a political song than anything else, but in the context of a relationship, it feels like I've been caught up in your trap again. It feels like I've been wearing these same old chains. But good will conquer evil, and the truth will set you free. And I love you till the day I die. You know, it seems to work because you're still married.
So 30 years you've been seeing them, mm-hmm. And you're not a groupie, just to set the record straight.
No, because a groupie is different. I don't know. What's the definition of a groupie? I'm not sure, but no. It's not me. It's not me. At least I don't think it is. We don't consider ourselves groupies. It's probably, I'm not going to underestimate, but I'm quite sure it's probably over 1,000. I would imagine over 30 plus years. I would imagine it would probably be about that. But I'm not a groupie, so let's remember that. Let's clear this up. Not a groupie.
I was very resistant to seeing the B Street Band because I felt that nobody could do Springsteen music like Springsteen. And the first time I was walking up to the deck and I could hear Atlantic City. And as I was getting closer and closer and I heard how awesome it was, I said, I'm in. Like, I totally bought into this band. I said, that's it, I'm sold. They were unbelievable.
Everything dies, maybe that's a fact. Maybe everything that dies someday comes back. Put your makeup on, baby, stand up pretty. It made me the man in Atlantic City.
I generally make a spectacle of myself to the point that I have been out to dinner at places and, you know, totally unrelated to my B Street nights. And I always get, hey, I know you. And my husband starts to cringe because he knows that it's because of B Street. And I get, I know you from B Street. And he cringes because I do make a spectacle of myself here, but once again, I love it and it's fun and people do recognize me, which is sort of comical at times.
It's so worth the drive. Like, I'll say, oh my God, I spent 4.5 hours on the parkway in traffic. And then they play the first song and I'm like, it was all worth it. It was so worth it.
When Bruce isn't around, the B Street Band, they're everything to all the fans. They truly are.
I mean, there is nothing better than sitting there, closing your eyes, and hearing music that is like poetry to your soul. There is just no better feeling.
Give yourselves a hand!
The satisfaction you get out of the experience is actually more fulfilling in some ways than since seeing Springsteen on stage.
To me, Bruce is my salvation. So when I hear this music, it just makes me so happy and enlightened. So that's why I come.
You know, they say, I'm just saying, Frankie fell in love. They can do that. They can do that. And a lot of the tribute bands can't. You know, they stay on top of the new music.
Our Juliet said Romeo's been found. Frankie fell in love. Well, peace is gonna break out. Romeo
didn't take out. Sorry.
And you don't want them to stop. You don't want them to stop. And you put on the E Street channel on the way home, you know, and you can't wait to go see him again tomorrow night.
We've played those songs 10 times, 20 times as many times as Bruce has ever played those songs. So think about that. You know, we've done that many tunes. And I still get it when a crowd reacts and you see a smile and people singing and showing, getting a feedback on it. It kind of refreshes it all the time.
Right now, the Cubs are playing pretty good baseball, and the energy in our dugout is incredible. And everybody tells me how much they like seeing us play. High praise, high compliment. The B Street Band, everybody loves the energy of the band and how they play, and it's fun to watch them. So I want more. So it goes beyond just the mechanics of doing things, hitting or playing an instrument, whatever. People feel your energy. People feel your passion. And that's how they become a fan. It's not just because you are a band that plays Springsteen music or that you're a baseball team in the major leagues. You have to demonstrate something that the people, the fans, could feel and could be and want to be associated or affiliated with. And I think that's what they, I'd like to believe that's what we do, and I know that's what they do because I've seen it. And believe me, I look forward to hearing them all the time.
The connection part to the audience. Okay, do you have a connection with the audience? Do you spend time with them? Do you listen to them? Do you communicate with them? All that. That's a part of it also. I think that's why we've survived all these years as a tribute band, because we have a little bit of each of those. I think Bruce would be glad if he could just walk out into the audience after a show, you know, just say hello to a few people without getting mobbed totally, you know. That's the one thing he can't have that I have, you know, so. And some nights I feel like I'm at my wedding. You know, at the waiting line on the wedding, when you get off stage, it's like a line to say hello. And it's people that you know for, you know, so many years there.
We're privileged to do this. We have, there's a million guys in line behind us that would love to do this. You know, I mean, it's such an incredible honor, you know, I mean, and to be as popular as we are for what we are. I mean, we're a bar band that has done Springsteen music for so many years, and we played for, you know, probably millions of people, of different people over that time period. And how many musicians can say they do that? That's just a small, tiny fraction percentage, you know? And to be able, I'm 62 years old now. I mean, to still be doing that when we started so many years ago, I mean, most people wouldn't ever believe. They couldn't believe it.
You really do, on some level, touch people's lives, you know? Which, again, I guess you gotta hand it to Springsteen, because he's had that kind of effect on so many people's lives.
Sure. Yeah.
Playing 200 gigs a year, they're working their asses off to make it happen. And it's, you know, for them, you know, quite a grind. When they get on stage, they light up, but the effort that goes into booking the gigs, getting to the gigs, doing their own, you know, setup of sound system, going through the sound check, playing, and then driving home at 1 a.m. for 2 hours or 3 hours, it's just mind-blowing to me. And then, you know, at the same time, they're leading normal family lives. It's just amazing.
I've always wanted to be his roadie in the off season. I mean, if my wife would permit me, I would do that. Just to help him pack up at the end of the night, that'd be awesome. But I do. Listen, you know, people always just, like with us, they just see the game, the finished product, what's going on. But there's so much work that goes into that behind the scenes. But we have people to do that. Willie is the behind the scenes.
Yeah, for me, it's just, I mean, the fires have started already. I have, you know, people calling in about changing dates and can they do this, and you know, I mean, it's like the first thing in the morning I gotta wake up to, it will be at least a dozen emails that I have to address immediately, you know. And it's not just yes and no answers, it's things that I have to think out. Because we want to play every weekend, I have to deepen and figure out and create something. If there's nothing there that fits that genre that people are asking for, then I have to create something. Winter time is tough in the north to play, because things slow down in the northeast. Then you have the weather, you know, and all of that stuff to go. So you got to plan to get out of the area somewhat and get away. And Florida for us is
is probably the place to go. Even though, because of my relationship with Joe Madden, I am looking at going out maybe out to Chicago a little bit too. That's another area I'd like to go out. There's always something for me to work on. It's never done. For me, it's been it's going to be almost 24 hours by the time I get home. You know, about 23 hours today. So I missed almost a day of sleep. So that means that somewhere down the road, I'm gonna be tired. I'll catch up with you. Yeah. But it's all good. I think for me personally, it's tough. My wife knew what she was getting into when she married me. You know, it's tough. I have to admit, I don't give my family the attention that I think I should. They lose me on the weekends a lot in the summertime, and I really don't get to go away with them or spend quality time. So I've kind of created a monster for myself. But I've given my family good opportunities. My kids play lacrosse. They get nice things, and they live in a nice neighborhood, and it's really. You know, I have a better life in a sense than my parents did, where I grew up in Pennsylvania, even though I loved growing up where I did. I think, so it's worked out all right, and I think that's part of the sacrifice I had to make. My wife says that I've been saying every year for the last 15 years that we'll probably go one more year, but I'm going to give it, I think we can go one more year.
So there I was, 15 years old, about the same age as Willie's son, William, in the basement of my house.
Good drummer.
Playing drums to records. One of those records was The Wild, The Innocent, The East Street Shuffle, which featured Vinny Lopez on the drum.
All right, Vinny!
And so, it's a thrill that on my way here tonight to come to work, I picked up my friend, Vinny Lopez. I need the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but it's fucking pretty cool for me.
And I stood stone like a midget, suspending my masquerade. Now comb my hair, it was just right. Yeah, command of the night brigade. I was a man of pain and crossed by the rain and walked on a crooked crust. I strode on through a fallout zone, laid down with my soul on toast. I hand out a crowd, forth of the crowd, when they said sit down, I stood up. Help me now.
The common thread that runs through the fans and the band is a place called the Jersey Shore. The B Street Band's story has helped baby boomers and Gen Xers revisit a romantic time in their lives, where all that mattered to them was being down the shore and listening to native son Bruce Springsteen. Bruce, too, was mired in this culture back then. The music, the ocean, the boardwalk. Live music was the thing to do in Jersey in the 1980s. And now people get to relive that time in such places as the Deck at the Golden Nugget in Atlantic City, or Jenkinson's in Point Pleasant, among many other places.
I think it brings you back to that place where life was easier, life was different. You know, the world was your oyster.
Well, for me, Bruce Springsteen, actually, since I was a little boy, probably 10th grade, backseat of my car with a girlfriend, just listening to Jungle Land, my all-time favorite Bruce song. To this day, Bruce. Just all the history of from Born to Run, Jungle Land, Thunder Road, all the great songs that just bring back memories for people certain times in their lives.
I graduated from high school in 1979. I grew up in Trenton, New Jersey, and back then, the drinking age was 18. So there was a lot of clubs in Mercer County, and there's lots of rock and roll bands that played all over. And I think the first time that I saw the B Street Band, which was called Backstreets, was 1980, 81. and I think they were in Wildwood at the time. We were on vacation, and my friends and I are great, huge Bruce fans, and we saw the band and fell in love from then on. And from the last 35 years, we've been seeing them whenever we can, because we've all gotten married and had children, but yeah, and we've seen them evolve over the years.
From the streets of Hazleton, PA to the big stage, it took one guy, Joe Madden, to convince Willie Forte to play Bruce Springsteen back in 1973. Nearly 40 years later, over 200 gigs a year, the B Street Band is still going strong, making a living of paying tribute to the boss.
Joe and I came from such humble upbringings, you know, and we talked about this one time about how on the same night in New York City.
Well, he's playing at B.B. King, that's like right on, 43rd or 42nd and 8th, something like that, right near Times Square, very famous venue, and he happens to play a gig down there for the first time, and at the same time, I happen to be managing my first game at Yankee Stadium.
On the same night, with my name on the marquee, and he in the Yankee Stadium, and he thought, he said to me, would you ever have believed that you and I would be in these two positions in the same night?
I mean, there's not many kids out of that group that follow these crazy paths. I mean, to be a rock musician or to be a baseball, Major League Baseball player or manager, I mean, not many people do those things. But we do, and eventually we come back and converge once again in New York City of all places. I mean, how does that happen? How does that happen? He grew up on Vine, I grew up on 11th Street. Both of our moms are Polish, which is our, and you know, both the Italians, the father's side's Italian. So we have so many things in common. But we had a blast with him, and that's how it started. Of course, it was supposed to.
This is planned all the while.
Right. I mean, listen, I've always been a positive thinker. You always imagine the best, never the worst, and you have to dream big. If you don't dream big, man, it'll never come true.
Hall of Fame right here. Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. This ain't no bullshit. This is where we meet. This is where the B Street Band meets to do its thing. We're on the Garden State Parkway, exit 98 for those of you who are into that kind of thing. What exit you from?
And we're still rushing.
This is the back of the car. This is me closing the car door. This is the stuff they don't teach you. And we're off.